Justin Cohen with Amulet Bloom. Antonio Del Moral Leon with Splinter Twin. Let's find you a champion of Pro Tour Fate Reforged. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night, wherever you are around the world. Welcome to the final match of Pro Tour Fate Reforged here in the capital of the USA, Washington, D.C. I'm your host, Rich Hagen, alongside Pro Tour Hall of Famer Louis Scott Vargas and the Pro Tour historian Brian David Marshall. We are about to watch this man, Justin Cohen, with his Amulet Bloom combo deck that has been tearing the building apart, along with his teammate Sam Black. And he is up against this man from Spain, Antonio Del Moral Leon, the 20-year-old with Splinter Twin. We are into a best 3 out of 5. And Brian David Marshall, the action's going to come thick and fast.
Yeah, I was just tweeting. I feel like this match should be a bloodbath for Antonio, who has permission and, you know, a turn 4 kill that he can sort of sift through in his deck that Justin can't interact with. But, you know, Justin is capable of winning this game on turn 2 if there's not a disruption spell from Antonio.
Luis, how do you see things going?
I think Antonio is favored, especially in a best of 5 match where he has access to Blood Moon in his sideboard. But, I mean, if we look at our opening hands here, Justin, if he draws a Titan or a Pact, has a turn 2 Titan if Antonio doesn't find a way to disrupt him, and he doesn't currently have that. And Dispel is not the card you want in this scenario, though it does stop Pact, so that part is good.
So quite a lot of action already from Antonio Del Moral Leon. It is Justin Cohen that we're anxious to see how he opens up. You have his hand on screen, a Pact of Negation, Amulet of Vigor, the signature piece of the combo. Also, Summer Bloom that lets you lay all those extra lands. You get a look at Leon's opening hand, or just beyond opening hand. You see a Vendilion click there amongst his collection. So we're going to open up with an Amulet of Vigor for Justin Cohen. That means any of his lands that come into play tapped, they will get to untap. That's what Amulet does for you, and that can generate a ton of mana. As Moral passes the turn with 2 mana up, there's the hand for Justin Cohen right now. Those 7 cards.
So Justin played a little bit conservatively here. I would have almost expected him to lead on Serum Visions, but I guess he was playing around Mana Leak, so he led on Amulet, but he led with a land that can't cast Serum Visions, so he basically gave up the dream of casting Serum Visions and casting Summer Bloom, but I think he is, again, looking to play it a little bit slower here, since if he had led with turn 1 Summer Amulet or Serum Visions off Gemstone Mine, he could play turn 2 Summer Bloom, bounce line, bounce line, bounce line, Titan. Of course, he's missing the Titan part, which is, I think, why he chose to take the slightly longer-term path where he doesn't use up counters on Gemstone Mine.
The draw a card was a second Amulet of Vigor. Then he gets to scry 2, and looks like certainly one went to the bottom there.
Yeah, I think he put a Zeus on the bottom and left his Serum Visions on top.
Right.
Antonio actually has less permission than you might expect. He's got a lone Dispel, which does counter Pact, but other than that, he doesn't have no Remand, no Mana Leak, and what'll be interesting to find out is if he casts a Pestermite Deceiver on Justin's upkeep here.
Now, BDM, you did a deck tech with Justin Cohen over the weekend where the way they described what happened when there were 2 amulets in play was they kind of glossed it over in a kind of, yeah, crazy stuff happens.
Well, they're not redundant. What happens is when a permanent comes into play tapped, you get 2 triggers of untapping it. So when you play a Karoo, like a Gruul Turf, you can untap it, tap it, and then untap it again.
Right.
For each of those. So you get 4 mana from each play of land on the say a Summer Bloom, which also means when you play get your Primeval Titan into play, you can actually do Slayer Stronghold and Sunhome Fortress all in one single activation off of your from your Primeval Titan coming into play.
Right.
And kill your opponent, do 20.
And the second amulet means that Justin has access to near infinite mana once he's resolved a Summer Bloom or even a Titan. It goes kind of nuts. The question is, will he be able to resolve a Titan? He's got Pact of Negation, and he has a Titan on top of his deck at this point.
Keep your eye on Del Moral Leon's hand. He has a Deceiver Exarch in play. Remember, that is half of the two-card combo.
He's missing the fourth land and the twin, I believe. Actually, it looks like he may have picked up a Scalding Tarn. So he's a Splinter Twin draw away from being able to win. He's choosing not to cast Vendilion Click, not to cast any other of his action spells. I think Justin is going for it here because he drew an Ancient Stirrings for his turn. His draw step rather, or off Serum Visions. So he knows there's a Titan on top. So if he can generate enough mana here, he might be able to end up casting Ancient Stirring, finding the Titan, have Pact of Negation back up.
So we're looking at Cohen from his side of the board. He's the man with the plan right now. He's got the action to make the play here. The life totals are not a massive deal in this matchup because generally Cohen is going to go from 20 to shuffling up his permanents or somewhere near 20. And on the other side of the table, Del Moral Leon could make a difference quite what he's on, but his life totals are likely to go down in gigantic chunks, similarly in a combo style kill.
Yeah, one might even say titanic chunks, as the case may be. But Antonio's got a bunch of options here. He's got Deceiver and Pestermite. He's got a Tectonic Edge if Justin ever ends up with four actual lands in play. He's also got Vendilion Click. He could Vendilion Click Justin. The funny thing is, if he Vendilion Clicks Justin and takes Ancient Stirrings, the Titan's the top card anyway.
Justin Cohen's found some nice cards on or near the top of his deck today already, even under Avon Mind Sensor earlier in the day. As you get a look at that Pestermite on the right of shot.
The Amulet triggers are on the stack here for Justin, while Antonio thinks about if there's something he wants to do with his Pestermites. Or Pestermite, as it were.
A 2,000...
Actually, Pestermiting the... I guess if he knew he had the twin, he could also Pestermite a Primeval Titan as it came into play.
Yeah, and that does buy him some amount of time. Justin having the Pact Negation in addition to everything else... Justin looks like he's actually in pretty good shape this game.
It looks to me like Justin's just trying to develop his mana on board. Not really as... Here is Vendilion Click in response to the trigger.
So like I said, this is actually not as good as you would imagine it would normally be, considering Justin knows that Titan is his top card.
Will Antonio take anything? Will he take the Pact of Negation?
Oh, yeah, of course. And you can't actually get Titan off Stirrings. So he kept us Titan on top. So he was actually...
Yeah, you can only get colorless off Stirrings. I thought you meant Summoner's Pact.
Yeah. So Justin was actually casting Summer Bloom and just...
Just developing his mana.
Yeah. And hoping to hit a Teleria West off the Ancient Stirrings, I suppose, is the plan. So... Now Antonio has to decide whether the Ancient Stirrings, because that's clearly the threat card, whether it actually will chain into a Teleria West. He knows Justin left a card on top, though. And here the second amulet's actually been pretty useful because it's generating a lot of mana for Justin here. He's going to end up playing a lot of bounce lands this turn. So this is a complicated turn.
It's hard to leave him with the Stirrings here, right?
It is, but if you take it, there is a Titan. Antonio's got the, like, why me look on his face as he's looking at these four cards, trying to figure out what exactly his opponent is up to. Because clearly his opponent didn't cast Summer Bloom and start generating mana with nothing, right?
Just for fun.
I mean, that's...
And it could be that he's saying, you know, my opponent has Teleria West on top. But then it doesn't matter.
Yeah, so... You're in the spot where if your opponent has Teleria West as the top card, it doesn't matter if you take Ancient Stirrings or not. It just costs an additional green if you don't take it. If the top card is Titan, clearly taking Ancient Stirrings is a disaster. But...
Yeah, he says keep him.
So I like that. I like that play. He correctly assessed that Ancient Stirrings cannot directly get Primeval Titan. Clearly Justin has a plan here, though.
Plan involves having a lot of mana.
The other thing is, Justin still, if he doesn't go off this turn, does end up with a lot of mana, or a lot of mana sources in play. He ends up with a lot of lands in play because of the additional land drops.
That's one of the things the deck does when it can't just go off.
He's got the sub game of keeping at three lands though because of Tectonic Edge.
three green, three blue, red, white.
Eight mana floating.
He's one green.
So seven mana floating.
Just the seven.
And so the two cards left on top were Titan Stirrings, or rather Titan Talaria West. So with the double amulet here, I mean, I imagine this is where Justin does get to win the game, right?
I believe he does, yes.
And because of Vesuva, like you pointed out earlier, it doesn't matter that he's got both Boros Garrison and Slayer's Stronghold in play already.
He may not be able to, because part of it is usually involves getting the Slayer Stronghold and the Boros Garrison on the because you activate it twice when the
right
when the Primeval Titan comes into play on double amulet, which brings it to a 10. So he may only be able to do... Oh, but Leon is at 17. He might be only be able to get him to one here.
8-6 doubled.
Yes.
The funny thing is, had De Leon not played Vanillin Click, he would have had... He would have been able to dispel the Summoner's Pact, but it's hard to predict that he had exactly Summoner's Pact... Or exactly Ancient Stirrings into Titan on top into Summoner's Pact rather than just having Titan in hand. Or just having Summoner's Pact in hand, because that also would have gotten foiled by Vendilion Click. So now Justin, I mean, he knows this, you know, this is a big time. So.
Another red, another white.
Another red and white. Boros Garrison critical to the end pieces of this puzzle.
And so he's got one land play remaining, I believe. So he gets to play.
Last line play. Another green. Another blue. It's three green, one blue, two red, two white.
Pro Tour Fate Reforged, the puzzling.
Yeah.
So he picks up the garrison, but he doesn't have a play on the garrison anymore.
Leave red, white floating.
Yeah, so he's not able to play Boros Garrison from his hand anymore because he's out of land plays, but he's got, presumably got a bunch of red and white floating here.
Right.
And he knows he can't die next turn to Splinter Twin. He does have to be aware there is a Tectonic Edge in play, and he does have a Summoner's Pact he has to play for, potentially two, depending on how this sequence goes.
So Vesuva gets pulled to the front, ready to copy another land.
Probably a Slayer Stronghold here. So if he has enough red and white, he
can get Sun. If he has enough red and white, he can get Sunhome and Vesuva. Copy Slayer Stronghold and then use Sunhome on a 10 power Titan, but I don't know if he has enough red and white because that requires red, 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 white, white, white.
Don't think he does. Last time we actually heard him over our effects microphone, don't think he has that much red and white.
I mean, he's going to have a ton more mana floating if he gets the Gruul Turf and Celestia Sanctuary here, but that does.
That does leave him open.
I mean, he's not gonna win the game on the spot, right? Well, actually, he gets to an attack step, too. He gets a second trigger, so he gets to... He doesn't get to float the mana till then, but he does get to have those lands into play untapped.
Worth noting, by the way, Justin has to make some decisions quickly.
Yes, I think at some point... All right, so now he's setting up the second Titan, presumably. I mean, with the Teleria West Gruul Turf here. I mean, it's not an easy deck to play.
No,
but
it's really difficult.
But if, you know, for those thinking about playing this deck in a tournament, you've got to practice it a lot. You can't basically try to, like, derive the plays from ground zero every turn.
I can certainly attest to that. It was one of the longest nights of solitaire magic in my life as I tried to play the amulet deck. in preparation for today.
Untap.
Use
red and white. Right there.
So now the Titan is bigger and better and ready to rock.
His 3 mana left.
Sorry. And this trigger's still on the stack.
What?
Alright. So
this
trigger's on the stack. Okay. With that on the stack, I'm using my red white floating to do this.
Yes. You have one red, one white.
Yes.
Two blue, one green. Green.
Yes. Yes, and I'm using the red and the white.
Okay. You
yes.
Red.
Okay. So green, blue, blue.
So now Justin it's deciding what to pull back. He's not pulling back the Teleria West, it looks like. And he has no more land plays this turn.
So right now he has an 8-6 hasty...
combat.
So no mana floating because he's going to combat. Send with Titan for 8. Get a bunch of lands. He can attack for 16 here. Well, he doesn't even have Boros Garrison in his deck anymore, so or in play to Vesuva,
right.
So he can't even activate Sun Home. At the end of this, I don't think Justin, you know, looks like he's not planning on winning this turn, but he still has Pact of Negation up, a Titan in play, Antonio at 9, and potentially a second Titan in play if he ends up getting some bounce lands, returning to Larry West, and ending up with West in his hand. Well, actually, he doesn't have quite enough mana because he can't transmute during combat. I don't know who was saying this deck was not complicated. Because
do you know, the more I watch him in action, the more I'm reminded of another modern Pro Tour and Stanislav Sivka.
Sure.
With eggs. You know, just the way that it's largely uninterrupted. It's not taking as long, but, you know, just in terms of every intricate decision that most people aren't really aware of, and then you go into the tank and you keep doing the right thing, and you have to do it over and over and over and over. And here we are in the final, and Cohen is still going.
So he has to pick up two of these lands.
He does. One, you have to imagine it's Teleria West. He does have to, again, watch out for Tectonic Edge if he ends up with four lands in play. I guess he actually can't end up with four lands in play, given that he has to pick up two of them.
Right.
So right now he can pay for his pact, even if one of those lands gets destroyed. Though, with three lands in play, that's not even going to happen.
Yeah. Blood Moon would be quite the beating if it was.
Yeah.
Game
well, Cryptic Command is the card that Justin may be worried about. But, you know, next turn he's got to pay for pact, and Titan's going to get tapped down by a Deceiver, which he then gets to blue pact and presumably win the game against. But he's got a bunch of the lands in his hand, so it'll be interesting to see what he ends up doing here. And I imagine getting another Summoner's Pact here with this Teleria West, since the second Pact of Negation is not quite as useful. He could be getting a land, though. I mean, that is also a legal target if he really wants to.
Now, conventional wisdom says that Leon is favored once we get past game one in terms of sideboard.
By the way, this is turn three.
Right. But you have to feel that this is absolutely critical for Cohen. If he can win game one, well, then a stumble at some point from Leon. Suddenly, you're only one game away from the title. If you're one down to a matchup that's meant to get worse and starting out badly, well, then you're a lot closer to a Spanish victory. So a huge moments for Cohen.
And he can win on turn two, you know, on the play.
Yeah. Well, it looks like he almost cast that Summoner's Pact there. You just not want to do that. So if Leon has the fourth land in hand here, he's really looking to draw a twin, but I guess he's actually got Dispel for the pact, so... You know, Leon, not in as bad of shape as you might think, I guess, because Cohen has to now pay for Summoner's Pact. He's going to get his Titan Deceiver. Leon just needs to draw Splinter Twin here.
That's crazy.
Yeah, after all that, I did all that work, and because I imagine Justin is going to want to cast Pact of Negation on Deceiver Exarch, in which case Leona's going to get to dispel it, but then Justin doesn't have to pay for the pact next turn, which means he can then Summoner's Pact next turn for another Titan. And even though the second Deceiver slash Exarch comes down, one of the Titans still gets to attack, presumably, which should be enough, depending on how much mana Justin can generate, which looks like near infinite. Justin's actually almost capped by the amount of lands he can get from his hand into play, because they're no longer in his deck. He's got like the Boros Garrison and the Slayer's Stronghold both in his hand, where he kind of would rather those be in his deck instead of in his hand.
Clearly in search of a brainstorm effect.
Well.
Aren't we all?
Simeon Spirit Guide here could provide interesting opportunities. We'll see if that extra mana comes up or not. And Justin also has to be feeling pretty good about his Titan attacking this turn because he has the Pact of Negation in hand. But as it turns out, Leon has Deceiver plus Pact backup, which is nice. And you know, at some point, Justin's life total starts to get threatened here, because Pestermite plus Vendilion Click, that's 5 a turn. And there's a Lightning Bolt in hand, too.
Justin now trying to decide if he wants to let this resolve or not.
Yeah. And you have to remember that Justin knows that Antonio knows that Justin has the pact, because Antonio saw it with the Vendilion Click. Not saying that Antonio would have played differently regardless, and I think Justin is still going to, use the pact. It makes the most sense. But Antonio's definitely going to take the opportunity to dispel that here. Getting a Steam Vents in case he draws Splinter Twin, because that would just be game. I mean, if Antonio can win this game where he has a hand with no Remand Mana Leak Spell Snare, and Justin has double Amulet,
and his Blood Moon sitting in his sideboard.
Right, that does not bode well for Justin. Not saying that Justin's draw is perfect. He had to jump through a few more hoops than maybe he would want to in a normal game. But, I mean, he resolved Titan with two Amulets in play, and Antonio still has a shot at winning this game.
All right, there's the Dispel.
I mean, assuming Justin can pact and then play Titan next turn and then win off that, Antonio still is the one who is on the burden of has the burden of drawing something. But
right.
But it is not over. Antonio gets a draw step. First of all, if he hits Splinter Twin. Second of all, if he draws another piece of permission.
Cryptic Command.
Yeah, or even like a Remand for the Titan. Doesn't look like Mana Leak's quite going to do it. And Remand actually might not either, honestly, with how much mana Justin has available. Though he 6, does 7, have a, 11.
Yeah, it does have a Spell Snare for a Summer Bloom.
Yeah.
Pass the turn, says Cohen.
I wonder what Antonio's hoping to draw here.
Oh, taking a page from Li Shi Tian.
Is that a Flame Slash? I think so. I think that's the wrong Rise of the Eldrazi card.
He can kill the Titan here.
He can, and he could also Tectonic Edge the Slayer's Stronghold, making it less likely that he gets Titan again. The advantage of that, I mean, he knows that there's a Summoner's Pact coming. Because his other play is to attack Justin for 5, and then Deceiver Exarch, the Primeval Titan that's currently in play. But then Primeval Titan plus Boros Garrison means you get attacked by a Titan for lethal, it looks like. I don't know if there's a way around that. So that's why I think I would favor the Slash Bolt and then edge the Slayer's Stronghold. Oh. Unfortunately, you really didn't want to use this Bolt because you wanted it to be lethal next turn, but I don't think you have a choice.
Just to be sure, 7 damage at Primeval Titan.
Yeah, I think it's always important to play around Bolster 1.
That's come up a lot for you, did it in testing.
Oh, yeah.
No packs. No packs. No, no.
Yeah, just confirming that there are no packs to be paid for in that upkeep.
It's an Azusa.
That is, in fact, an Azusa. One very unfortunate part about this for Leon is that he is unable to draw Splinter Twin for the win if he has to use Tectonic Edge this turn, which it looks fairly likely that it will. On the plus side, let's say Justin plays the Titan. It's prevented from attacking with Tectonic Edge on Slayer's Stronghold. Then next turn, Antonio attacks Justin down to 7, and then the Titan's prevented by attacking again by the Deceiver in Antonio's hand, which then lets him attack down to Justin down to 2 in the air and draw a Lightning Bolt for the win, or draw a land Splinter Twin for the win.
So, 2 red, 2 white go into his mana pool.
Oh, Antonio did not want him to let the Boros Garrison return trigger resolve. Well, because now Justin, because he drew the Azusa, he can play Titan, play Azusa, play Slayer Stronghold, immediately activate it, and Tectonic Edge no longer stops that.
Wow.
So Justin actually drew the perfect card to make this possible.
Top part of the deck continues to be kind to Justin Cohen.
Summer Bloom wouldn't have done it. Well, it might have done it anyway, because then he still would have had the...
Summer Bloom would have been fine, too, yeah. Because if he taps for spells,
then
he can't use
then
edge.
He can't, yeah. Then he can't do the edge, yeah. And one blue floating.
So Justin has to make sure not to expose Slayer's Stronghold to Tectonic Edge, but he's well aware of that.
So he's used one land drop this turn. He's going to cast Summoner's Pact. Wow.
Here comes Primeval Titan.
Two land plays remaining.
Antonio's not going to be feeling great about this spot. I feel like a lot of Justin's opponents had similar expressions on their
yes.
face over the course of this weekend. Like, what is going on exactly?
Right.
Oh, that. Mm, that's
and,
not
and,
good
and
for
I
me.
Think, and I think blue. If you got a chance to play this deck a second time, those. You know, you probably could get a different result quite often. Just because you become more familiar with it. So Titan comes into play, triggers, goes and gets 2 lands.
It could get Vesuva Sun home here.
No, I have red white floating. Red white.
Not sure what he can use red white for, but I'm sure he'll think of something.
Oh look, the handy card push tool has has discovered something you could do with it.
Oh.
Okay, now we could see a Pact of Negation backup.
Yeah, I mean, because we know Antonio's hand, we know that no miracles are forthcoming. But Justin is going to play around it. Though, even though if Antonio had a relevant spell, I assume he would have cast it by now. Still, it's good form to go get Pact of Negation with Teleria West here. Justin's then going to use one of his remaining land plays, of which he has at this point, and then... Play Slayer Stronghold, activate it on the Titan, and attack for 8 right now. And
blue.
Probably do some other things too, but that's ultimately what is going to end the game, is the Titan attacking for 8.
Problem? You think I have one more blue?
Yes.
I should have got, you're right, I should have gotten 3 blue, you're correct. So I will leave that floating. Red, white, blue floating. Thank you.
He double bags this game.
Yeah. And it's important to note that had Antonio been able to Tectonic Edge the Slayer Stronghold, the game certainly wouldn't have been over, but it would not have ended this turn, I don't believe, because the Titan couldn't get haste, and then next turn Antonio could tap it down.
Leaving blue in pool.
Blue in pool.
Wow.
Sweep up permanence. Justin Cohen's Amulet Bloom takes game 1. And in terms of the final, guys, that's got to be one of the best things that could have happened to it. We will be right back for game 2 after these messages.
Ultra Pro is the place to go for all your Magic accessories. With card sleeves, deck boxes, playmats, and portfolios showing off the best Magic art, Ultra Pro is the standard in safe storage. Visit ultrapro.com for more information. Vampires, dragons, beasts, monsters are awesome, and so are Magic fans. So we're giving Magic 2015 Duels of the Planeswalkers players the new Master of Monsters card pack as a bonus. Get these 30 new all-foil cards added to your digital collection as a bonus starting February 11th. Visit MagicTheGathering.com now to learn more.
So, there is only one player in the feature match area right now, and that is because Justin Cohen has gone off to rehearse his victory speech. No, I don't think that's the case. I imagine it is a bio break for him. And we get to look into what the players are doing. Here he comes back again, and we're into sideboard territory. So let's us go inside the tank of the blue-red Splinter Twin deck of Antonio Del Moral Leon. He's got a couple of Keranos, the legendary enchantment creature god out of Theros. You've got Jace, Architect of Thought, a couple of Spellskite, Ancient Grudge, Anger of the Gods, two Blood Moons, and then on the bottom row, it's Singletons all the way, Dispel, Flame Slash, Negate, Pyroclasm, Shatterstorm, and finally, with the double blue casting cost, Threads of Disloyalty. So, Luis, we felt that Morale was probably favored in the matchup, and partly we feel that that's because once game one's out of the way, it gets better for him. Walk us through some of the reasons that might be true.
There are really two main reasons. They're both named Blood Moon. If Blood Moon resolves and Justin isn't able to either float a green mana and cast Nature's Claim or have his one basic land in his entire deck, Forest, in play, or have a Sealab Primordium in play, you know, a couple different outs, but still, if he doesn't have one of those cards, he's just dead. I mean, he's unable to cast any spells. He's unable to do anything. So Blood Moon's a huge, huge trump.
So this might sound facetious, and I promise that's not what I'm being here. I'm asking a straight question. Are you saying that from a two-card winning combo of turn three, Deceiver Exile, turn four, Splinter Twin, he is literally, it meant much of the time, into a one-card combo kill? That is called Blood Moon. He goes, look at my opening hand, didn't have a Blood Moon, ship it back. Look at my opening hand, have a Blood Moon, I've got you.
Well, the matchup's good partially because Antonio doesn't need to side or mulligan into Blood Moons. If he has a Blood Moon, he's you know, got a really, really good chance of just sticking it and winning. If he doesn't, he still has plenty of good hands that win the game. Having Dispel and Negate also help. Ancient Grudge for Amulet seems plausible to me. The rest of the cards seem... like, basically, his creature interaction, like Flame Slash and Lightning Bolt, are not really what he's looking for. He just wants permission, Blood Moons, and the combo.
Let me ask you a question, Luis. Is Spellskite a card that could possibly come in? It doesn't do anything against the hive mind into things, but you can actually steal the activations from Slayer Stronghold and from Sunholm Fortress.
Yeah, it's the sort of thing that if you have extra sideboard slots, you probably do bring it in because it does buy you turns. It's not the sort of thing that you necessarily want as a windmill slam, but you know, the fact that it also protects Blood Moon against Nature's Claim and Seal of Primordium, that makes me a lot happier to bring it in. I would imagine Antonio's going to find room for that looking at his list.
Well, I've been paying close attention, Luis, as the day has worn on. And one of the things that you've taught me today is that it turns out Justin Cohen doesn't have as much room for maneuver in his sideboard plans just because so many of the combo pieces are intricate and interacting with each other. But this is what he does have to choose from. Hornet Queen, which did great work earlier in the day. Sigarda, we haven't seen much of her. A couple of Thrag Tusk and Wormcoil Engine. Clear the board with Fire Spout. The You Can't Target Me Leyline of Sanctity. And then Singletons along the bottom. Claim, Clasm, Primordium, Song, and Ghost Quarter. So, not so much room for maneuver. What is he looking to do out of his sideboard?
The cards that jump out to me are Nature's Claim, Seal of Primordium, and Swan Song. I really can't imagine wanting any of the other cards. It's a pretty light touch, but you know, that's, you can't have a great sideboard against every single deck in Modern. There are way too many decks. And this is a combo matchup where your deck is already a combo deck designed to race, so there's not much more you're looking to do.
So in with artifact or enchantment removal, basically, is what we're looking at there. Enchantment, 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 the common thread on all three of those. So to what extent do you feel that Leon is now advantaged as a result of sideboarding?
You know, I thought he was a slight favorite pre-board. I think he's got draws that beat Justin's best draws. And now that he's got the Blood Moons in his deck and the extra counters, I think that edge increases. So, I mean, I wouldn't want to put a number on it because it wouldn't be accurate, but I would say that Leon has a reasonable advantage. I mean, I would say somewhere in the vicinity of above 60%, maybe higher.
Sure. On the plus side for Cohen, He's already one up. And if, at some point, Leon comes back and wins a game, then, as you said, BDM, he will get the chance to be on the play once again. And that then opens up the possibility of turn two Titans, which potentially Leon can't do a lot about. There is a kind of, there are some bullets in the chamber for Cohen.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The deck is capable of a theoretical turn one kill, I believe, where you play the Simeon Spirit Guide to play your Amulet and then do your whole thing off of a Summer Bloom and a Karu. But, you know, turn two would be the dream there.
Sure. So Leon is looking at his opening hand, seven right now.
Land, Exarch, Blood Moon, Cryptic Command, which is, dispel potentially. Just either way, you snap it off. There's a Blood Moon and there's three lands in there. Which
right. So here we go with game number two of the final of Pro Tour Fate Reforged. And you see, non-basic lands are mountains. And they are both keeping, so we are away. And it will be Leon who kicks off because he is 1-0 down and chooses to be on the play. And land number one for Cohen is a gemstone mine, which he will parlay into only two counters left, draw a card off the Serum Visions, and will then scry those top two. So where do they go? Double top, double bottom, or
I guess that depends
on
whether or not they're nature's claims. Right? That's what he's one of the cards he's really thinking about here.
And it doesn't look like, I mean, from the glimpses we're catching of Justin's hand, he's got anywhere close to the turn two win here. I mean, he's got a decent mix of cards, but I'm not seeing a Summer Bloom, and I'm not even seeing an Amulet necessarily. Right. There might be one, but he's at least a card away from doing something along those lines.
Take a look at Antonio's hand.
So there's the Exarch, the Blood Moon, the Cryptic Command, plus three land. We know that Cohen has kept one card on top, pushed one to the bottom, off that Serum Visions.
There, and there's Cohen's up there for you now. Pact of Negation, Summoner's Pact. Summoner's Pact, Hive Mind, Boros, Garrison, Tendo, Icebridge, Teleria West.
Yeah, so Cohen can cast a turn two Summer Bloom if he left that on top, but he does not have access to Amulet plus Bloom, certainly. Antonio really just wants to draw, like, a Mana Leak.
That is an Amulet of Vigor off the top. So that's what Justin Cohen decided to leave himself for this draw step.
Well, he's got to start assembling the combo somewhere, but from the looks of things, Antonio's just going to resolve Blood Moon next turn, and we're going to see if we were exaggerating how much it ends the game. I mean, he's got to be... The thing is, he may not just slam it. He knows about Swan Song and Nature's Claim, but... You know, the fact that he has the Splinter Twin combo actually makes it a little more interesting because he could potentially also go Exarch, untap Twin. So he's got some tough decisions here. The funny thing is Justin's reasonably far away from comboing, so I could see Antonio wanting to wait.
Yep. He's going to pass the turn.
So Justin needs to draw a Summer Bloom exactly here.
Did not. Drew Simic Growth Chamber.
Justin basically looking at playing a land. He might play an Amulet here. He's not going to be able to pay for anything but no packs next turn. Antonio couldn't counter that even if he wanted to.
There's the growth. Trigger the Amulet.
Now he might transmute for a pact here.
He could.
But then he can't. Yeah.
If he transmutes for a pact, then he still has gemstone mana, but then Antonio goes end of turn. All right, so Antonio's just going to Exarch Deceiver him out here, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Slaughter Pact is like the only card you're worried about, and even if Justin has Slaughter Pact, he then has to like lose his gemstone mine and pay with Simic Growth Chamber. Oh, he gets the Slaughter Pact. So now you know about it. That actually changes things. So now I would imagine your play is just to play Exarch, but then play Blood Moon. Because, you know, even if Justin had mana up, I think Antonio's play next turn is land Blood Moon with Dispel up. Because right. that plays around all the potential outs Justin has. Because you don't need to land the Splinter Twin. All you need to do is land the Blood Moon. Justin's down to Forest plus one of his two green cards to stop Blood Moon. At some point, we may see Justin Teleria Westing for basic Forest, by the way. in wow. anticipation of a Blood Moon.
So, the Exarch resolves at end of turn. Deleon untaps.
Get a fetch land so he can get another island here. He's way too excited here for Justin to be happy.
Yeah, I was going to say, you don't need to be a big student of body language here, do you? There is Blood Moon.
Congratulations, Louis Scott Vargas. You win a new caw. Justin took out an Azusa, a Hive Mind, and a Colony Garden for Seal of Primordium, Nature's Claim, and Swan Song.
There we are.
Deceiver Exarch attacks 4-1. And back we go to Justin.
I would say how about we go to game three. Yeah. But it's the finals of the Pro Tour. Justin has a basic Forest and a couple outs to Blood Moon. He's got to keep playing for it, even though Antonio is going to likely just play Splinter Twin next turn to win the game. Because, first of all, he gets the second red off Tectonic Edge because of Blood Moon. Second of all, Justin can't cast Slaughter Pact because Blood Moon's in play.
Yeah.
Those two together are a bit of a team.
He points at the Blood Moon to let Justin know that, yeah, you will not be paying for Slaughter Pact.
That is going to be game.
Yep. Thank you so much. 1-1. Boom.
You hear a roar go up from the Spanish players.
So he played an extra turn beyond the Blood Moon. He played one extra turn before getting actually comboed out.
Well, had Antonio not had the twin there, I think he just wins 17 turns later is the most likely case.
Now, I was going to ask you how that would have played out, because when you talk about normally you sweep up your permanents, but hey, it's the finals of the Pro Tour. Were we actually looking at a game that was going to go potentially very long? And if that crops up again, because obviously Blood Moon is going to stay put and could be central, are we going to see on Cohen's side, does he have a few turns to try and find that random forest and so on?
Well, the thing is, Cohen has to try and assemble the combo of Forest plus Nature's Claim or Seal of Primordium, plus Pact of Negation is actually fine there because you have to assume you win the fight and your lands become unlocked anyway.
Right.
But that's one basic land plus two cards plus packs, whereas Antonio has to just at that point find any number of, you know, Remand, Dispel, the combo pieces, Mana Leak, Mana Leak probably doesn't do it, but the rest do. Cryptic Command.
I like your idea of Teleria Westing for a forest.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes
if you can do that on the first, you know, second or third turn of the game and you don't have an immediate combo to assemble, I like just going and getting the forest.
Well, why don't we take a look at Blood Moon, because it's a curious old card, a vicious hoser. And when we say hose, like a fire hose, basically it's from the era of Magic where you really wanted to punish people for playing particular decks. The world of Chill, the world of Boil, the world of Choke. We're not talking about things that empty cards one at a time from a graveyard. We're saying, are you playing islands? I'm going to put them all in the bin right now. And here you see one of those style of cards, Blood Moon, non-basic lands,
Vicious Hoser.
Vicious Hoser, indeed.
That's a very, very good term. I just want to take a moment here to thank Luis for curating the art for these segments that we do where we feature cards.
Right.
He personally selected these cards to show off here. So I thank him for that.
It is a very, very beautiful Blood Moon, that is for sure. I do have a somewhat more serious question for you, Luis, which is not just about Blood Moon, but a variety of cards that we've already alluded to in this little segment here about hoses. It is very unusual that a format is sufficiently positioned where cards that are this focused and this, in a sense, narrow, although it affects so much of the lands, but it's a very, very specific effect. Very rare that cards like this go into the main deck in formats. But we are seeing, in Modern, people running Blood Moon main deck sometimes. To what extent do you think that that's a right call for the most part? Did you, as a team, was that something you paid attention to, whether cards that were that specific we're going to go main deck in things?
Blood Moon is a kind of interesting case because it is a narrow card, certainly, but in Modern, you can pretty much count on everyone to have non-basics. There are not very many decks that have a lot of basics. It's not usually as extreme as this Amulet deck, but it is the sort of thing where you know, if you expect a lot of decks, like, you know, even like the Obzon decks, a lot of times Obzon decks do get hurt by Blood Moon. You know, they're trying to operate on lands like Treetop Village and Gavinny Township to provide extra effects. You're also trying to look at limiting just their colored sources. And Blood Moon hits a wide enough swath of the field that I think it's a very reasonable card to main deck. Cards like Rule of Law or Stony Silence, not so much. You just can't put those in your main deck.
You've had a chance there to take a look at the opening hands for both players. Only one of those is still in hand, and that's Antonio Del Moral Leon. He's going to keep his remand and his stomping ground and his steam vents and his spellskite, the cryptic command you see over there. And so he's happy with his seven. Meanwhile, Justin Cohen said no. Not unsurprising, really, given that I believe it was just Talaria West plus bunch of spells you're not doing anything with.
Yeah, this isn't the optimal hand by any stretch for Antonio on the draw with just a two-mana counter, but you cannot mulligan as if Justin's going to have a turn two Titan, because if you do that, you're lowering your win percentage. He's just not going to have it often enough that you should ship what is a perfectly playable hand. It's got Peak and Remand to cycle into more cards. It's got a Cryptic. It's got a Dispel for a Pact. It's got a Spellskite to kind of wade through Disruption and slow Justin down by a turn. So Antonio has to keep this hand, I believe. But, you know, he is vulnerable to turn one Amulet, turn two Bloom, as are most decks in the format.
So six cards will go into Justin Cohen's hand.
And Justin's deck, by the way, does not mulligan super well.
No, like right here, his only
still
land is a bounce land. So I would be surprised if he can keep this, but I mean, if he kept it, I wouldn't call him wrong because he knows so much more about the deck. But yeah, given that his turn on play is go, that doesn't sound like a good hand to me. I would generally not like to do that on my first turn.
Let me ask you a question, Luis. If you ever have a deck like Amulet, which is becomes a little more volatile as you mulligan, and you have like more, you know, these unkeepable hands, are you on the draw more likely to keep a marginal hand, like, is that just something you just want to disregard and go right in?
Even on the play here, I have to imagine that if Justin's hand is like Amulet, Summer Bloom, Bounceland, Titan, one other random card that isn't a land. Sounds like a keep to me. I mean, maybe it's not. Maybe, you know, Sam will now chime in on Twitter and tell me that I'm wrong. But this is a combo deck. You have to mulligan pretty aggressively, but you also, the lower your hand size gets, the looser those standards become. It's a lot different than like a deck like Obzon, where all the cards are so replaceable.
Right.
Speaking of Sam, he actually suggested Vesuva, Tolera West for Vesuva, Vesuva Island, Antonio's Island, to get around Blood Moon, and then cast Hive Mind.
Oh!
So, I don't know if that's how Vesuva interacts with Blood Moon, but, you know, that is what Sam's suggestion was.
So, here we go with five cards in hand for Justin Cohen. It's 1-1 here. We're down to the best of three in the final of Pro Tour Fate Reforged, coming to you live from Washington, D.C. On behalf of all the folks at Wizards of the Coast, we hope you're having a great time here with us. Rich, Luis, and BDM here in the booth with you. And we're going to see a Serum Visions, so draw and then scry two.
And Antonio does have Peaks, so he's going to get to see what's going on. Justin's hand's pretty slow, but he has some of the cards he needs. I mean, there, you can certainly do worse on five. That is just factual. One of these players looks a lot more excited than the other. And Antonio waiting on Peak to presumably end of turn.
Yep, there we go.
So he gets to see a hand of all the cards you'd want, just about. You're missing an Amulet, but you've got two Ancient Stirrings, Summer Bloom, and Summoner's Pact. So Justin needs a Bounce Land and he needs an Amulet to really start getting things going. The Ancient Stirrings, if Justin can find a green source, can help find those things.
Yeah, the green source is a really big deal for Justin.
Remand looks like it's going to be very good this game, too. Justin is going to be pretty short on mana here. And I think overall, Antonio is going to be pretty happy, you know, basically using Remand as a time walk, making Justin spend an entire extra turn replaying whatever spell it is he plays. I have a hard time imagining that he wouldn't just slam here. I don't actually know if I love slamming Spellskite there. But
oh, he still does not have the...
No green.
No
green.
Well,
there's Amulet. He left that on top, so he knew that was coming.
So step one.
It looks like it worked out to play Spellskite. I would have liked to have Remand up in case Justin had a green source on top. But most of his green sources do come to play tap, so maybe it's good to get Spellskite out in a turn where you don't think you're doing anything.
That's not a green source, but it is a way that potentially he can find one. It's another Serum Visions. Ideally, he doesn't want the Scry to find it. He wants to just draw it.
And I like Antonio's play of letting it resolve. Remand does basically nothing here because Justin has an extra blue source. Using a negate is kind of overdoing it. You're just using a hard counter on a Serum Visions. And Serum Visions sees three cards, but you're still going to get to those cards eventually. You're not winning. Like, if Antonio was winning for sure in two turns, I could definitely see negating there. But he still is looking for Splinter Twin here. And given that that he has Cryptic Negate Remand in hand, I think he's happy just letting that happen. And Justin did find a Simic Growth Chamber, so he is going to get to generate some mana. So, and the sick part about all this is Antonio could just draw Blood Moon or Splinter Twin and end the game at basically any point.
Mm-hmm. But has not. Not here.
No, he has not. So we're going to get to watch Deceiver rumble into the red zone a few times here.
Oof. 20 down to 19. So there's the Simic Growth Chamber that was left on top by the second Serum Visions. It will get to untap, courtesy of Amulet of Vigor.
So Justin has access to one green mana this turn. And total of three blue. Antonio has Remand Negate or Remand Dispel are reasonably likely here. Justin also has Hive Mind Summoner's Pact, so he has, the combo. But he's not quite getting to that point here. Not through the cards Antonio has in his hand, though. This is not a bad mold of five, all things told.
So trigger off the amulet.
Looks like Justin's considering picking up the Simic Growth Chamber. It looks like he's actually going to pick up Teleri West, and then, because if he picks up Simic Growth Chamber, he might go for Summer Bloom here. But it looks like he may want to take a little bit longer, potentially transmute for Blue Pack to try to set up a win next turn, and that also kind of denies Antonio the turn of four, a turn where he would have been able to use four mana.
The thing is, if you're trying to work out what's in Antonio Del Moral Leon's hand, and you're not watching like we are, what is it that you think he's got if he hasn't got the combo and he hasn't got things he wants to put on the board? What is it that makes you think you're going to get through what's left in his hand? Are you just assuming that he doesn't have much?
Well, you can pretty much cross off Twin and Blood Moon off the list because
right?
I don't think Antonio is going to play scared about Swansong. That was the only card Justin could have had. You have to imagine his counter magic. He's not just won't have very many dead cards left in his deck. He's not, he took out four Lightning Bolt to Electrolyze. Justin may not know that for sure, but you can't imagine Antonio's got a bunch of those kind of cards left in his deck. So
Antonio did his best to show him some there, but yeah. Managed to recover in time.
So Ancient Stirring's on the stack now. Again, Justin can't go off this turn because he's used his only green mana. He can't cast Summer Bloom. And Antonio knows that. So he has to decide whether he wants to spend some time valuing here. He could do something like Cryptic the Ancient Stirrings, countering it, and then bouncing like the Teleri West or Simic Growth Chamber.
Bouncing the Growth Chambers, well, I guess not that big a deal if you're with a Summer Bloom.
That might not actually be good because you know that next turn he's going to be able to go Simic Growth Chamber, return it, Summer Bloom. But what Antonio does have incentive to do is he could just Cryptic counter draw. Again, Antonio's got a ton of instant win cards, and you want to use your mana here. I think given that you have four counter spells in your hand, I really like using the four mana one this turn, because next turn you're going to be a lot more worried about having to play around Pact of Negation. So I like Antonio's instinct to use Cryptic here, and I actually think I'll just draw a card. I mean, I think bouncing can be interesting, but I like draw.
That sounds like what he's doing. I believe he just said draw.
He did, yep.
All he wants is red cards.
Using my floating mana.
So Justin's in an interesting spot here, too, because he can't... Because the Ancient Stirrings got countered, I think he was hoping to pick up a bounce land off that. If he was able to pick up a bounce land off Ancient Stirrings, he could just transmute for Blue Pact here. Now, he can still do that, but he doesn't have a bounce land to go off with Summer Bloom, so he may feel inclined to get a bounce land here. It may be that he needs the blue pack plus bounce land to win the game, so he's better off getting blue pack and just hoping to draw a bounce land. But as things stand, Justin's next turn, if he doesn't draw a bounce land, is just going to be cast Ancient Stirrings, go. I mean, he still gets to look for it. So the fact that he has the second Ancient Stirrings makes getting packed here, I think, pretty much a no-brainer. But countering the Ancient Stirrings was annoying for Justin.
Did Antonio Del Moral Leon find a game ender in that last draw step?
He found Snapcaster Mage.
Yeah.
So he's getting close to Rich's favorite phase of the game where you get the Snapcaster Mage a cryptic command.
I do like that. But I like not casting Serum Visions here. I think that you know that Justin's gearing up for a big turn. Yeah, Radiant Fountain not really going to be part of that. And if you can hold Justin off, then... You know, every turn that goes on is better for Antonio. His deck draws way more live, and he's got more things to do. So Justin, I think, is going to lead with the Ancient Stirrings, looking for the bounce land. The question is, does Antonio counter this too? Is he aggressively countering Ancient Stirrings?
It's a little different here because Justin hasn't played a land yet, and Antonio doesn't know that Justin really needs a bounce land.
Well, he found the Simic Growth Chamber. So this, I mean, even though Justin isn't going to be in great shape against Negate, Remand, and Dispel, he can't necessarily play like Antonio doesn't have those three counters. And I think this is the turn where he wants to go for it. Simic Growth Chamber, untapping it, returning Simic Growth Chamber, cast Summer Bloom. If it resolves, play three lands, all Simic Growth Chambers. Again, cast Hive Mind, Pact Invocation, your counter spell, cast Summoner's Pact, and you lose off Hive Mind. What I think is going to ultimately end up happening, though, is Antonio is going to, you know, fight a counter war, and Antonio has three counters, and Justin has Hive Mind plus Pact Negation, which does not line up correctly.
No, things look very good for Antonio Del Moral Leon here in game three. Players tied at one. Somebody wins $40,000 and a Pro Tour title and a seat at the World Championship, which will take place at PAX Prime in the last weekend of August 2015. That announcement made here at Pro Tour Fate Reforged.
Can he just slow play to another Pact of Negation here?
I would be surprised if that ended up being what Justin wanted to do. I mean, maybe he does, and look, if he's played Radiant Fountain, that's what he's choosing. But
I was just wondering if he could play the Simic Growth Chamber and then Talarian Academy. I mean, Talarian West, well, that he picks up.
He could have done that. It looks like he elected to play Radiant Fountain. He's going to let Antonio cast Snapcaster Peak, and Antonio's going to know what's going on now. I mean, maybe Justin feels like it's just too risky to go for it, and that's reasonable. I think it doesn't work out well for him if he does, but what Justin really wants is, I mean, his optimal is to go off with a Cavern of Souls Primeval Titan. That's a lot safer, but, you know, you don't always have everything you want, especially on a mold of five. Antonio's just thinking red card. I like using Snapcaster Peak there. It gives you a sense of what's going on and lets you draw additional cards, puts an extra creature on the board in case you do want to start attacking.
Not a red card, but another remand.
The extra remands aren't that relevant. Antonio still is in a spot where he's not even able to cast Serum Visions, which he's drawn multiple of, because he needs five mana to have two mana counter plus Dispel. Justin has the second Summer Bloom, so if he's able to cast Summer Bloom, have Antonio counter it. But the thing is, Antonio knows Justin's hand, so he's got to be pretty likely to let Summer Bloom resolve here, right? Because remanding a Hive Mind is really where you want to be, or just negating it. I mean, one of the ways I think Justin gets back into this game is if Antonio fights over Summer Blooms and ends up letting Justin, you know, sneak, you know, wear down his counters with Summer Blooms instead of with Hive Mind, which is less replaceable.
Now, if there is a potential chink in the Del Moral Leon armor, we've seen some interesting plays with counter magic in the course of the top eight. We saw a remand in the quarterfinals that led to a game three ultimately. And we saw another...
Summer Bloom has resolved.
Yeah. Which I ultimately... I mean, the extra information from Peak has to play into that. Like, if you're worried about
Titan Cavern of Souls, letting Summer Bloom resolve is much riskier, but once you see what's going on here, it's going to be hard for Antonio to end up on the bad side of this exchange. Please. Even if Justin's able to get his second Pact of Negation off of Teleria West that's in play, Antonio can go, you know, Remand, Negate, Dispel. That's three counters. Pact, Hive Mind, Pact is also three counters, but that, you know, all those cards cancel out, nothing ends up happening. There are some tricky plays coming up, though, and, you know, Remand is not a card which you can, like, Remanding, you know, some Pact Negation is not a good play. So you got to make sure you don't do something like that by accident, but I think Antonio, if he uses his counters judiciously here, is going to emerge victorious. At least over to counter ward. That doesn't necessarily mean he wins the game, it just means Justin kind of uses all his cards and Antonio gets to use all his counters. And be left with potentially a Remand or Negate in his hand because he can't cast all four of his counters this turn.
So use everything, and we have that Hive Mind on the stack.
My inclination is to Remand it. Hive Mind's an expensive card, and redrawing another card here is pretty nice. You also, you know, two for one Justin here because he did use a Summer Bloom.
That is what's going to happen. At least as far as the next step.
Oh, that was quite a nice draw. It looks like a Vendilion click. Because Justin looks like he is going to go off again here. He's going to cast Hive Mind, or cast Summer Bloom. Actually, the Summer Bloom's had enough mana that had Antonio negated the Hive Mind, he may have been able to do it. But because he chose started with Remand and Justin had the second Summer Bloom, now he gets to cast Hive Mind again. Justin, or and Antonio counters it, but Justin is still short of Pact Negation. He's not this play does not give enough mana to pull out the second Pact Negation out of his deck, I don't believe. So Justin's going to cast Hive Mind again. Antonio's either going to Remand or negate it. Justin's going to Pact that, and then Antonio's going to Dispel the Pact. I think how this is going to play out.
4 points.
So the Bloom resolves.
On a 5-card hand, too. This is Justin's tragically short here. He's, I believe, short just 3 mana or a Pact of Negation. Either one of those things would have done it.
So 3 green, 3 blue floating, 1 line play left.
That's fine. Yeah. How many lands
there? One left.
Four.
6 in pool. One line left.
Negate your Hive Mind. Pact of Negation, your Negate. Dispel your Pact of Negation. Proper counterspell wars.
Yeah, that is
That's
nice.
What we like.
So Justin isn't on the hook for Pact next turn because it got dispelled.
Mm-hmm.
He does have a Summoner's Pact in hand and a Simic Growth Chamber, so he can actually Summoner's Pact and play Titan next turn. Of course, Antonio has another Remand in his hand.
Oh, boy.
And now Antonio also has the Vendilion click he drew, and because he used up so much of his mana using counters, he's got, let's see, is Justin doing something else here? I don't think so. He looks like he's just playing the Simic Growth Chamber to make his Titan play better next turn. Antonio can start cycling through these Serum Visions and potentially leave up click or Remand, or just do nothing and leave up both. He knows about the Summoner's Pact and the Serum Vision, or in the Radiant Fountain, so he knows Justin's entire hand. So, you know, if Antonio goes Serum Vision, he can still Deceiver Exarch on Justin's upkeep, tapping a Simic Growth Chamber, and then Justin can't quite play a Titan. He'll end up at 5 mana total. Justin's life total may start coming into play here. He's getting attacked down to 14.
Presumably, though, before that actually becomes relevant, surely Dalmoral Leon's just going to find a Splinter Twin. Or indeed a Blood Moon.
Well, given that he's got multiple Serum Visions, if he chooses to cast them, he gets to see more cards. It looks like he's going to be content with Justin going for Titan and having Remand up.
Another Simic Growth Chamber.
I feel like it's really tough for Justin not to just go for Titan here. He's not winning the game if he just passes. I mean, I guess he can. He could wait a turn. He could transmute Teleria West for Pact Navigation this turn by playing Simic Growth Chamber and do that. But yeah, I like just playing Titan. It is going to get remanded, but you know he
doesn't stop it being the right play though, does
it? No, I mean if he just passes. I mean, Antonio didn't play a land for the past three turns and has five cards in hand. Like, you're not really in a winning position here. Even if you think, honestly, even if Justin thinks it's 90% that Antonio has a counterspell in his hand, it still may be right to do this because doing nothing, getting Vendilion clicked is just not going to win you the game.
Huh.
So Antonio's clicking in response to clear out a potential Pact of Negation, and then he's going to remand the Titan.
Right. Oh, yeah.
So that's good play, too. I mean, he just wants to make sure he doesn't lose to Pact. And now Justin's on the hook for a Pact next turn. He's getting attacked for 6 down to 10. And now Antonio finally can cast a bunch of Serum Visions. Oh, and he's drawn
that. He just wins on the Blood Moon here.
Yeah.
And that's the end of that.
the unnecessary Blood Moon. I think he was going to win that game anyway. But
yes. A format with a 3-mana, 1-card combo kill. Blood Moon.
But also required his opponent's summoner's pact.
That was also helpful. Yes.
Yeah, but again, summoner's pact or no, Justin wasn't coming around in that position. No.
So, here we are with three games gone in the final of Pro Tour Fate Reforged. Justin Cohen has had an amazing run in his first ever Pro Tour, the Pro Tour qualifier Madison winner from the United States, but he is 2-1 down and under the gun because his deck is not favored against the blue-red Splinter Twin of Antonio Del Moral Leon. He is 20 years old, and his team of Deceiver Exarchs here, and a little bit of Blood Moon there, and maybe a Splinter Twin, or maybe this guy, Snapcaster Mage, could be just one game away from giving Spain a Pro Tour title.
Yeah, and Snapcaster Mage does a really good job of letting this Splinter Twin deck bridge the gap between combo and control, or even aggro, because of Snapcaster Mage, you're able to recast Bolts, Remands, Serum Visions, Cryptic Commands, other counters, and that's what it attacks for two. I mean, that is what lets this deck play the way it plays. Without Snapcaster Mage, the deck has to either choose to focus on combo much more, it would have to focus on combo much more, or just look very, very different, but Snapcaster Mage is a huge part of it.
Once again, we will see that the play goes to Justin Cohen with Amulet Bloom, and he now must win this next game. Tiago Chan immortalized on Snapcaster Mage. Which of these two is going to be immortalized by becoming the latest Pro Tour champion? Do you see when you absolutely have to win a game when there are no more games that can possibly be played if you don't win this one. Do you yet again play just completely normally? I know that is the mantra. Just every game's the same. Every game's always the same. The stakes don't matter. Still true?
So we have this conversation every Sunday.
Yes.
Because it's an important one. And it's one that I think people will frequently misevaluate. Yeah.
Right.
You have to play the same. Like, you have to play as if every round is the same because presumably you're just making the highest expectation plays every time. Your opponents are sometimes different, and you do play differently against Hall of Famer Pro Tour champions than you do people you've never met before, because sometimes you have to make risky plays on one hand or the other. But in general, you should approach all games of Magic, that you want to win as if they were the same.
Well, we've seen Snapcaster Mage there. Why don't we take a look at another one toughness creature that isn't really about the one toughness at all. Here is Vendilion Click BDM.
Yeah, this is a card. Almost as soon as it came around, it found its way into Standard. It found its way into older formats. It's been a big player in Modern, big player in the blue-white-red control decks, the Splinter Twin decks, pretty much any deck that has access to blue mana and wants to use its mana at the end of its turn.
Yeah, and speaking of Hall of Famers, this is Paulo Vitor Domodossi's favorite card in Magic because it just does so many different things and things he likes to do. You get to play tricky cards at any of your opponent's turn. Here we saw it in response to a spell to make sure your spell was safe. It lets you push aggro. It lets you play a controlling game. It disrupts combo. It's just a very good card.
I believe that Guillaume Matignon actually ran with fairies in the modern rounds.
He did. So did Shota Yosoka.
Right. We tested with Guillaume. He's an awesome dude. I really love Guillaume. The whole time he's like, I'm going to play fairies. It's not good, but I'm going to play it. We're like, you don't have to play it. He's like, no, I have to play it. I'm like, all right, I guess you have to play it then.
He said, the deck is bad, but these cards are too good.
I mean, they're very sweet.
So the players down on the floor are looking at their opening hands, and Justin Cohen cannot cope with his first seven. So he is already going to six. Meanwhile, Antonio Del Moral Leon, he is looking at seven. Now, I cannot see. We have a couple of extra monitors than just that wide shot, but I cannot see any red cards. So there is no super fast Blood Moon sitting in his hand right now.
So Antonio's there's his hand in the tank here about keeping a one land Serum Visions hand with Spell Snare. It's on the draw, and you have Spell Snare that you could leave up. If he draws a land turn one, he could pay Steam Vents on tap, pass, and leave Spell Snare up to stop a turn two Bloom.
I believe once he's holding his hand up like that for the spotters, he has kept it.
Yeah.
That means it's being entered into the card viewer so that we can keep track of what's in his hand.
This is on the low end of keepable hands. I think that given how many the Blood Moons he and counter magic he has in his deck, I wouldn't be surprised if this was a hand he would consider mulliganing. But it's also a hand I can see why he kept it. I mean, having Spell Snare and Serum Visions, Spell Snare protects you early. Serum Visions also means you have a pretty good shot at finding lands on the draw here. Your opponent's also mulliganing, which makes it pretty reasonably less likely that you need the Spell Snare up on turn one.
Things are going to change here quite a lot on the basis of that Serum Visions. Right, because if that works out well, then suddenly things are really pretty nice. But if things work out badly from that Serum Visions, if for some reason there's nothing in sight and you're stuck with that one land you opened with, then maybe things aren't so great. Here's the six cards.
Looks like Ancient Stirring, Summer Bloom.
Mm-hmm.
And lands, which has got to be a fine hand on six.
So here we go with Justin Cohen needing to win this game of Ancient Stirring, Summer Bloom, four land, including the engine of the deck, if you like, the Simic Growth Chamber, all those Karus. So instantly, Gemstone Mine will go down to two of its initial three counters. And Ancient Stirrings, is there a colorless there? Well, yes, of course there is. You can see.
No amulet, though. That's the card that Justin was.
Yeah. He's like, I don't need another stupid Karu. But he'll take one.
So.
Oh, and there's land number two off the top.
Because Antonio drew a land there, it's so much safer to cast to play Misty and just pass without casting Serum Visions. He would have had a tough choice otherwise, and I think you probably have to cast Serum Visions. Here, he's got Spell Snare up. He's going to Spell Snare the Summer Bloom almost for sure. I mean, that's what the card is in the deck for. And Justin was just casting a value bloom here. He was just casting Summer Bloom to just play a bunch of bounce lands, which is basically close to how the card was intended in Visions when it first came out.
To go from two mana to maybe four or five mana.
And then six on your next turn.
Yeah.
I don't know why Antonio stopped Justin. That was such a fair play. Of course, he definitely should have cast that Spell Snare.
The permanent dark ritual.
Yeah.
Also, Antonio can't know that it's a fair Summer Bloom.
Oh, certainly not. Well, he knows there's no amulet in play,
right.
But he does know he doesn't want Justin to have a bunch of land, especially Antonio has a kind of slow hand here.
He just left another land on top, pushed a second copy of Spellskite to the bottom, and plays a tapped Steam Vents.
Justin's a hand of all lands here, which I guess is part of what you signed up for when you played this, but still, he can't be too happy. I mean, he's a number of cards away from mounting a relevant play here. Antonio's not going to kill him super quickly. Antonio's hand does not have Splinter Twin, does not have Blood Moon, so he's just opting. He's almost on the beatdown planet. He's going to go ahead and tap a land on Justin's upkeep. Justin just draws another land, and now with a Pestermite in play, Antonio's got Exarch, Click, Snapcaster, just got all creatures. He's more likely to just beat down with blue cards unless he draws a Splinter Twin or a Blood Moon here.
Pestermite on the board. Del Moral Leon, a Splinter Twin away from a title. Doesn't have it, though. Not right now.
Five
cards in hand.
Again, just playing the tempo game here and keeping Justin off his plays of more lands because it's all he has so far except
drawn a Primeval Titan off the top.
And, you know, if Antonio doesn't draw... well, first of all, if he draws a red card, the game is presumably over. If he doesn't draw anything else, he can still tap one of Justin's lands on upkeep here if he wants. He could also leave Upper Man instead.
Cohen at 15.
If Antonio had one more land, this would be a little easier. He could tap a land and leave Remand up. Now he doesn't have the option to do both. He can play a Deceiver to untap his own land. I think he's just going to keep Justin off six mana. This plays around Justin drawing Pact a lot better.
What he's drawn is Talaria West. And the board is building for Antonio Del Moral León.
You know, Justin is going to get to transmute Talaria West for Pact of Negation. Next turn, he can play Titan with Pact of Negation back up. Given the cards in hand, Antonio can't exactly stop that, though he could play at some point a Vendilion Click. If he draws a land, he has Vendilion Click plus Remand up, which, as we saw last game, he's likely to click Justin in response to Titan, take the Pact, and then Remand the Titan. Justin's getting pretty pressured here, and... You know, the ticking clock is always there. Antonio could always just draw a card with a red mana symbol on it.
Yeah, we are absolutely. We're looking for red because red will be the stop sign. It'll be time to finish this Pro Tour, and it will be time for Spain to celebrate. Needs to find it, though.
Oh, this is, of course, even better than getting Pact of Negation. Cavern of Souls, the other way to stop a counter. And now, but now Antonio still has the option of Vendilion clicking Justin on Justin's draw step, which if Justin doesn't draw a second Titan, this does stop him from doing that. He could, you know, it actually might be interesting if Antonio wanted to click sooner than that, because assuming Justin already has one Titan in hand and maybe doesn't have Pact of Negation yet. The remand in hand, not particularly relevant here. So I wonder if it's better to click on draw step or click main phase. Because if you click main phase and Justin has a pact, he has to pact then and pay for it. If you click draw step and Justin has drawn a pact, it's just so much worse for you. I like the main phase click. I think that actually ends up being much better. You certainly just take the Titan and leave Justin with the hand of literally all lands.
An army of gribbly little men sitting in the center of the table.
And Antonio's two attack steps away now, so he's got to be feeling pretty good about this. Justin has to draw off his Vendilion Click, draw off his turn. So he's got two draw steps to find a Titan to go with his Cavern. Hive Mind doesn't do anything. Pact also works because Remand doesn't stop Pact. Summerbloom doesn't do much.
It's a Pact of Negation.
had Antonio waited, Justin would have drawn the Pact of Negation, pacted the click, played Titan. So that Antonio really got paid off for that play. And in fact, actually, Antonio's going to make it a one-turn clock, right? He can just play a Snapcaster Mage. If Justin's at 11, that does do what he needs. Not a one-turn clock, still a two-turn clock. Mm. But it still might be fine to play Snapcaster here because Antonio doesn't really have anything better to do, and he has double Snapcaster. Justin's got one draw step left, but it's not clear that him playing a Titan will stop this army. This is a lot of creatures, and Justin doesn't have an amulet in play, which really limits how much he can really go off.
Yeah, the Simic Growth Chambers are a lot less exciting when you have to bounce some other land and...
So Justin did play Summer Bloom to kind of set up his board. He's under the assumption that he will draw... a Titan at some point. I'm kind of curious if... I guess Antonio doesn't know about the Pact Negation, so he has no real incentive to remand there. If he knew about the Pact, he probably would have remanded the Summer Bloom just to cycle remand and try to draw a red card.
Are we going to see the Snapcaster Mage at end of turn?
I like it. I mean, I guess Antonio doesn't have any bolts in his deck, so it doesn't actually increase the clock much. But, you know, if Justin plays a Titan next turn, you might need all your creatures as possible in order to try and get through. Because Antonio does have double Snapcaster in hand. And there's no way you have enough mana to play to use both. This game is also not lasting two turns, so I like the running out of Snapcaster.
Justin's just making sure he's not dead to the Snapcaster.
The one red card in the deck that doesn't win the game, Ancient Grudge. You know, that's not as bad of a draw as you might think.
No, actually.
Because it stops Amulet outs a little bit, even though Justin still has Pact in hand.
He drew the Amulet.
But he still needs a Titan.
Oh, yes.
There's the face of a Pro Tour champion. It is Antonio Del Moral Leon from Spain. Congratulations to him. And look at that. He cracks a smile finally. He's been so straight-faced throughout the top eight. He kept it all together. He gives a little shake of his head there. He cannot believe that he is your Pro Tour champion, but he most certainly is. And there's the grin. He is going to be deluged by his Spanish friends. You can be certain of that. Congratulations to him. A great run by Justin Cohen, of course, to get all the way to the final. But in the end, we end up with Antonio Del Moral Leon taking the title. Congratulations to him. My goodness gracious me. He has done it with Splinter Twin. Brian David Marshall.
This is the first Pro Tour champion from Spain in the history of the Pro Tour. I think Joel Calafell in Kuala Lumpur, and I believe he has another top eight.
He made the top eight, yep.
Yeah, you know, has gone as far as the quarterfinals, but we've never had a Spanish Pro Tour champion before.
Awesome.
Absolutely amazing stuff. Great, great stuff. Now, Jelgar Vigasma in the semifinals, he must look at that and think, boy, oh boy, do I wish I was sitting down there.
I mean, it's pretty brutal seeing that you have maybe a 70 or 80% potentially matchup in the finals, but what can you do?
That's magic. Congratulations to Justin Cohen. But
great job
to your champion from Spain, Antonio Del Moral Leon. We'll get to chat with him at the news desk in a little bit. Why don't we head over there for more reaction from this great Pro Tour? Here's Marshall Sutcliffe and the guys.
Thank you, Rich. Welcome back to the news desk. Great stuff. We have now completed our Pro Tour experience here, and that was an interesting finals.
Not
what you normally see. Not a lot of creature combat going there.
Yeah, a lot of careful, patient play between both players. But yeah, congratulations to Antonio for pulling it out there.
Yeah, what did you make of the finals there? It was an intricate match, to say the least.
Yeah, definitely. A lot of really intricate lines of play there. Cohen, you know, trying to navigate his way through a lot of counter spells and at times just having to kind of give things up and say, hey, if you've got the Splinter Twin, I'm dead. I just got to take a risk and go for it. Or the Blood Moon. Yeah. Another instant win, essentially.
Yeah, I don't know. When I was watching it, I definitely felt like there were so many turns where at any point, if we just saw some red mana symbols come off the top of the deck for Antonio, then he would just be our champion.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
And now he is.
And now he is. So congratulations to him. We're thinking he's the first Spanish Pro
Tour
champion.
First Spanish Pro Tour champion ever.
Yeah, so congratulations to Antonio, awesome. Our champion. So to walk you through the tournament, let's take a look at our bracket, and we can sort of reconstruct how the top eight went, in case you're just joining us, and eventually work our way up to Antonio Del Moral Leon, our champion. So Eric Froelich faced off against Jesse Hampton. Jesse beat him to advance to the semis. In our next match, it was Justin Cohen versus Seth Manfield. That was Justin Cohen defeating Seth and his burn deck. Next, we had Antonio against Li Shitian, also with the burn deck.
Oh, my goodness. Remember that quarterfinal match? How close and tight was that one?
That was a close
Both players are like, top deck to win. Oh, no, yeah. I have to give you another draw phase. Top deck, no, I don't win. I have to give you another draw phase. No.
That's
super
right.
Close. And in the end, if Li Shitian had the Molten Rains in his deck in the spots where the Boros Charms used to be, his opponent's at three, and he draws the Molten Rain on the last turn.
Just to
laugh
at.
It was that close to get to knocking Antonio out in the quarters.
Yeah, and instead, Antonio advances to the semis, which put us to our last quarterfinal match, where Jelgar Vigasma, the Hall of Famer, gets by Jacob Wilson, who, you know, was looking to avenge his runner-up at his last Pro Tour top eight, but it's going to have to happen a different time for Jacob.
I think we'll see him again.
I do agree.
What is he, 12 years old
he's
now?
He's 20.
19?
19. Yeah. He's 19. He's 19. So in our first semifinal match, Justin Cohen got by Jesse Hampton in what was ultimately a good close match.
Yeah,
But Justin Cohen emerging victorious there. That put Jelgar Vigasma with Splinter Twin against Antonio Del Moral Leon, also on Splinter Twin in the mirror match, and it was actually quite quick. Antonio dispatching of the Hall of Famer. This is Antonio's second Pro Tour. Put him up against Justin Cohen in his first Pro Tour. Not a lot of PT experience in the finals. And Antonio Del Moral León is our champion here with a very unconventional deck. I have to say, you know, looking at the metagame breakdown from day one, we did see this deck in the hands of some capable pilots here, but, you know, is this... So, when we look at Splinter Twin, it's been pretty consistent throughout the course of Modern, and it's still here.
Right,
you know.
It's been around. Samuel Estrade won the first Modern Pro Tour with Splinter Twin.
Right.
And if you look at the metagame breakdown here, if you divide up, like, the Twin archetype has been bifurcating. You've had Tempo Twin and Tarmo Twin, and there was a Grixis Twin variant that Makihito Mahara and some other Japanese players played here.
Humble Twin?
Absolutely, Humble Twin. There you go. Humble Benefactor out of Fate Reforged.
Love it.
So those guys showed up, and there were like eight of those. There were like a dozen of the old school. If you folded all the Twin archetypes together, they were about the third most played archetype.
Okay.
You know, they were tied with Infect and Affinity, I believe, for third, behind Obzon and the Burn Deck, which was the second most played. So if you roll them all together. I mean, there's a lot of variation in that archetype, but I mean, it was one of the decks people expected. It was, I think, expected to be the most played combo deck, and was, in fact, the most played combo deck. Mm-hmm. Pretty interesting to me that the two twin decks that made the top eight were both the sort of just old school, just blue-white combo, you know, just, you know, some control.
Blue-red,
the control version of the deck without any of the sort of fancy stuff.
What do you make of it, Ian?
I think Randy summed it up well. We've seen the Splinter
Good old Splinter Twin.
Yeah, this is the classic model, you know? Model T Splinter Twin, right?
Right. And so, you know, it's interesting to see going forward as Modern has taken bannings, some cards have come off the list, some cards have gone on the list, you know. And as we've seen, you know, certain decks have kind of peaked up again, and maybe Splinter Twin is one that is the new top dog. You know, we've seen Obzon here kind of be the deck of the tournament. But with two copies of Splinter Twin in the top eight, including the winner, it's going to draw a lot of attention to it.
Yeah, I mean, Yelger had the Jacob Wilson version, the wilted Obzon, which is not a good matchup on the Obzon side. The traditional Obzons are pretty good against Splinter Twin, but those guys were able to kind of duck and weave and, I think, dodge that matchup. I talked to Yelger. He only played one Obzon all weekend, so he's able to kind of avoid that. You know, it's like the deck that's weak against the most played deck, but good against everything else.
Right. And that seems to be a good place to be. Okay, it is time now for our award ceremony. We have our own Rich Hagen standing in the feature match area, and he's got some trophies to give out.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the award ceremony for Pro Tour Fate Reforged here in the capital of the USA, Washington, D.C. First, we welcome to the stage your finalist, winning $20,000 from the United States, Justin Cohen. Justin Cohen, your runner-up in his first ever Pro Tour. Fantastic job. But now, your champion from Spain, winning $40,000. The champion is Antonio Del Moral León. A fantastic job by the champion from Spain, Antonio Del Moral León. Here comes the rest of the Spanish contingent. We'd like to thank all the players, the judges, the staff, and of course you, the viewers, for being part of this pulsating Modern Pro Tour. That's the end of the award ceremony. Let's hand you back to the news desk and Marshall Sutcliffe.
You know, when I think of magic, I think of a mental sport. Not so much the big muscles,
like,
but
the flex?
You know, if you got them too,
you
might as well show it off. You need them to hold up that big check
there
anyway.
There you go.
So you see our champion, Antonio, and a huge smile on his face, and why not?
Of course.
He just won the Pro Tour in only his second try. And congratulations to him. We're actually going to bring him in for a quick word. For his winner interview after he's going to have to bring his translator as English is, of course, not his first language. He's from Spain.
Yeah.
What do you think it means to the people back home in Spain to pick up a national, a Pro Tour champion?
I think it's a big deal.
It's a big thing, right?
It is absolutely a big thing. I mean, you can see an entire community will kind of rally together, and it convinces everybody else, you know, I could do this too.
Yes.
I mean, you can see that somebody you know, or maybe you know their friends, just having somebody in that social circle. I mean, not that everybody knows everybody. It's a big country, but it just makes it feel that much more accessible.
It does.
It makes it feel that much more possible. And Magic players tend to get better by playing against other good Magic players, right? You seek out the people that are better than you and figure out what they're doing to win. And now, you know, everybody in Spain knows, yeah, we can do this too.
That's right. And it is interesting how you'll see some countries come together and have teams of pros over and over and over showing up at the Pro
sure.
Tour. They'll test together. You know, I think of the Swedes, you know, they tend to group up mm-hmm. the Dutch players as
oh,
well.
Oh, yeah, back in the day.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah, you get that one really good player, and then suddenly they come in packs.
Like yes.
It is actually unusual that you have, you know, a lone wolf off in the, we'll say, Canadian wilderness,
yeah.
right? It's unusual to have just one good player pop up out of nowhere. It's usually a whole crowd, and there's a whole scene of players that have been playing against each other and sort of helping each other get good.
Right. You know, I think of Willie Adel as well mm-hmm. as, you know, a pillar of the community. Now, it's not that Spain doesn't have players out here on the Pro Tour. They do. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you do kind of wonder when you get a Pro Tour champion like this if it can help thrust that forward and really solidify things for the Spanish.
It was a big deal. I remember when Japan had their first Pro Tour top eight and then their first win, and then just the floodgates opened and it was player of the year, player of the year, player of the year.
And they're still going.
Well, pretty much, kind of, yeah.
So we're getting Antonio mic'd up right now, and we're going to bring him in in just a minute for his interview. But exciting stuff. It's been an awesome weekend, Randy. We had
it has been.
A lot of awesome modern action. This is a format that is beloved by a lot of people. You know, there was a decision made before that we weren't going to have a Pro Tour with modern, and mm-hmm. that was met by a lot of loud voices saying, no, we love modern, we want it. And they decided to keep it. And
it was fun.
It was fun.
It was a lot of fun. I mean, we knew coming in that this was going to be a wide open format. There are going to be a lot of different decks played. I was a little surprised to see a deck crack that sort of 20% of the field mark. I mean, the Obzon deck did get all the way up to, you know, 25, 30% of the field. I think it was 28. But there was maybe one other deck that cracks 10%. You know, the Amulet Bloom deck we saw in the finals, I think there were only like 5 copies in the field. Maybe it was all kinds of decks. All
right,
over the place.
We've got our champion here. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Nice job.
So this is Antonio here, and there's Sebastian.
Yes.
And you're going to act as translator for
sure.
us, Sebastian. Thank you for taking the time. Yeah, let's get that check.
Oh, yeah.
Antonio, can you give me one of these? Yeah. So, Antonio, can you talk us through the last few turns and what you were feeling as you knew that you were going to win the Pro Tour?
Bueno, si puedes contar un poco de los últimos turnos cuando ya sabías que estabas a punto de ganar el torneo.
Nada, estaba tranquilo, no quería fetear nada, porque la ronda anterior el seto te quedó dos tierras y no sé, nunca se sabe lo que puede pasar.
Well,
hasta que no finaliza, pues...
He actually didn't want to celebrate, he was calm. He knew that the game before he had top deck a couple lands, so until the last moment he wanted to be certain that everything was going his way.
What does it mean for everybody at home in Spain to have a Pro Tour champion among your ranks?
¿Qué dice?
¿Qué crees que va a significar para todos los que están en España tener un campeón de Pro Tour?
Pues la verdad que no lo sé. Ahora mismo estoy sin palabras.
Right now, I really don't know. I have no words for this.
Tengo el móvil colapsado de toda la gente animándome.
My cell phone
está
is collapsed.
Todo el mundo conmigo.
His cell phone is collapsed with all the people trying to
His
speak with him.
His cell phone died.
No puedo móvil.
What's the plan for you now, Antonio? You will secure platinum with this win. Full-time Magic Pro?
¿Cuál es tu plan ahora que has asegurado el nivel platinum?
Dedicarme a esto. Dedicarme a viajar y jugar.
Well, basically, dedicate himself to just play and travel.
Wow.
So yes to full-time Magic Pro.
Full-time Magic.
Why not?
That's fantastic. Okay, congratulations once again for our champion, Antonio Del Moral León from Spain. And that, boys and girls, is going to do it for this weekend here from Pro Tour Fate Reforged. We had a fantastic time, a whole lot of awesome decks, interesting plays, great players, the whole lot. We want to thank the staff, the judges, of course, the players that played in the event, of course, you, the viewer at home as well, for joining us. for the rest of the coverage team, I'm Marshall Sutcliffe, signing off from Washington, D.C. We'll see you guys next time.